Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Can I now welcome our panel of witnesses to the meeting? We have Professor Sir David Edward, Professor Shona Douglas-Scott, Dr. Kirsty Hughes, and Professor Andrew Scott. And can I thank you all very much for taking the time to come and speak to us at the committee today. Can I just open by noting that it's now 7 days since Scotland voted overwhelmingly by 62% to remain in the European Union. And since then, this Parliament has had a vote unopposed to welcome that vote by the Scottish people and to mandate the Scottish Government to do everything that it can in order to protect Scotland's relationship with the European Union. In your view, what is the best way forward in terms of taking that mandate forward and protecting Scotland's relationship with the European Union, and what are the challenges and opportunities that the government faces? Basically, in a nutshell, what is the most effective scenario that you see that can protect our relationship with the European Union?
I don't mind going first. I don't need to press anything, do I, on the microphone? So good morning, everybody, and thank you for inviting me to join you at this sort of quite extraordinary and extremely difficult time. I think the vote has inflicted extraordinary damage on the UK, on Europe, even on the wider world. And the EU, as you know, is facing very big other challenges, not only managing Brexit, and they're challenges that the UK has mostly also anyway been stepping back from: the refugee crisis, the youth unemployment crisis, and so forth. So I actually think that's very important to keep that in mind in the midst of this huge crisis for the UK in terms of our own responses, that we keep a broad view in that response. I think it's absolutely right to do what the Scottish Government is already doing and explore all the options. No member state has ever left the EU, with the exception of Greenland and Algeria are the two examples we can give. In terms of preserving the relationship with the EU, you know, the simplest and most obvious way would be to be an independent state and transition in and stay in the EU. That's absolutely the most straightforward. The political question is it feasible? Do the Scottish public want it? But I think that's the most straightforward. All the other possible permutations and relationships, the reverse Greenland or other ways of keeping access to the single market, are obviously going to depend to some extent on what the rest of the UK does. So if the UK decides, which I think would be in many ways quite extraordinary again in the circumstances, to join the European Economic Area and so retain full access to the single market, but therefore have to have the four freedoms, including free movement of labour, but having given up, like Norway, all say and vote over those regulations. But you know, that would be an option. And with that option in place, if that was the option, would Scotland need to be exploring any of these other ways of doing things, short of the independence option at that point? No. Whereas if the UK decided to go for a Canada or Ukrainian type free trade deal or association agreement that had much less of the single market and much less free movement, then I think the options for Scotland in terms of exploring whether it can have a differentiated relationship with the EU, whether it could keep free movement when England and Wales didn't keep free movement, whether it could mimic or mirror or take on European legislation, is a complex and quite technical as well as highly political discussion, and I think that's very worth looking into. But I think it's very hard for me at this moment. I'd be very interested to hear what my other experts and colleagues on the panel have to say about this. For me at the moment, it's very hard to imagine how Scotland could be in the UK and still in the EU rather than just still in the EEA or still in the single market. you know, you're meant to be a state to have a seat in the Council of Ministers, not a sub-state. And I don't see at the moment any way around that. So obviously there's a lot more to be said, but I think I'll stop there.
Professor Douglas-Scott.
Yes, well, I agree with most of what Dr. Hughes has just said. And I think given the current apparent lack of strategy in Westminster and Whitehall, there will be a couple of months of uncertainty at the very least. But I think what I'd like to do is to address my comments to the two possibilities of either Scotland remaining within the EU as part of the UK, or alternatively an independent Scotland in the EU. Now, I think I agree with Dr. Hughes. It's difficult to envisage how part of a state could be in the EU, just part of a state. But I think one should distinguish legal and political issues here. And legally speaking, there's nothing very clear in the EU treaties. We know that there are precedents for part of a state leaving, the Greenland scenario. And as a result, and I would also add to that, actually, the situation of the reunification of Germany, too, because these examples illustrate that states can determine which parts of their territory should be members of an international organization or a treaty. And I think that's important. So legally, there are precedents. I think politically, it's another question, because it would be a matter not only of negotiating with the other EU states, but also with the UK to a certain amount as well. So I would distinguish those two things, that legally, the EU treaty is not completely clear on this. And even in the more general arena of international law, there are precedents for sub-state units forming treaties. Treaty conclusion is not just the preserve of the sovereign state. In federal countries such as Germany, the German lender have been able to adopt certain treaties. There are other precedents, for example, of parts of the Soviet Union, former Soviet Union, when they were still within the Soviet Union, becoming members of the UN, the Ukraine, for example. So there are these interesting possibilities. So it's one thing to cite these as precedents. It's another then to say, yes, it's possible to do a deal on the basis of that, because there would have to be agreement from other EU states. And I think it's questionable right now whether that could be part of an Article 50 agreement, in which case we'd be talking about a majority vote from other states, which would be favourable to this sort of flexible option that Scotland was looking for, or whether we would be talking about an amendment to the treaties which would require unanimity. And then just moving on to the issue of an independent Scotland. I mean, obviously there are issues that this would be a choice of the people of Scotland, but when it comes to EU membership, I think, again, there are legal precedents for saying, yes, it's possible, and these were canvassed at the time of the 2014 independence referendum, and I think a good legal case was made for Scotland's membership. But again, there are political difficulties. There are some states in the EU that are not so happy with that. Rajoy has been making comments already the past day or so. So I think I would separate out the two and say, yes, the legal precedents are there to be worked on, and then there is the issue of diplomatic, political relations, discussions that have to be had. And I wouldn't comment on that. I'd leave others better versed than me to comment on that.
So, David.
I largely agree with what has been said. I think stage one is one has to remember that one is engaged in international negotiations and intranational negotiations, and it is a basic principle of any negotiations to create goodwill. I think that steps have been taken to create goodwill with the other member states and the other institutions of the Union by the Scottish Government, and particularly by the First Minister yesterday. I think it is, you have to have in mind that it's also necessary in negotiations with the United Kingdom government to maintain a position of goodwill, which might be difficult, depending on how it emerges. But that's stage one. Stage two, I think, is to bear in mind that the people talk about options, but none of the so-called options are options that we can adopt, either Scotland or the United Kingdom can adopt unilaterally. Every single one of them requires the consent of others, even the so-called WTO option, which I can go into if necessary. The third point I think that one has to remember is there's a lot of talk about, oh, well, we don't trigger Article 50 and there is some form of negotiation in the margins. Remember that Article 50 not only sets down the procedure to be followed broadly as between the United Kingdom and the EU, it also includes a reference to Article 218, which sets out very specifically the procedure that has to be followed by the EU side in the negotiations. And as I see it, the purpose of the provisions of incorporating the provisions of 218 is to ensure vis-a-vis all the member states and all the institutions that their particular prerogatives are respected in the process of negotiation. I think, putting it very bluntly, it is to protect, for example, the smaller member states against a stitched-up deal between the member state that has intimated an intention to withdraw and the bigger member states on the other side. So we should not forget that when the when the Council has said we require service of a notice of under Article 50, that is because they have to observe a certain procedure on their side. And we should respect that. But I think beyond that, everything is to play for, I'm afraid, both up and down.
Professor Scott.
I can add very little to these comments. I agree with virtually everything that's been said. I mean, the two stages of this, of course, are political agreement. That has to precede negotiations. What is the negotiation going to be about? What is the mandate handed to the negotiators, both in the EU and likely the Commission, but there's already a struggle within the EU as to who the lead negotiations will be. And of course, within the UK, how do the negotiations match up there? So I think there's a political set of agreements which usually precede any decision of this type, although this is unprecedented, of course, but you know, when it comes to enlargement. So if one wants to reverse the enlargement argument, then it seems to me that taking the politics out of it, it would be important, of course, for the government in Scotland to examine the portfolios which most impact on Scotland. So, for example, you know, there's a number of portfolios that will have little impact on Scotland, on audiovisual or whatever, but there's some will have a very significant impact. So it may be one way to consider how to structure thinking about this at the level of administration and negotiation rather than the political level would be to do a kind of reverse enlargement. I mean, I agree very much with what Sir David said about relationships in Europe, how crucial they are to the way that the EU unfolds, and I think the Scottish Government has made fantastic strides in building those relationships at a time when, frankly, it doesn't seem that the UK government has a very clear idea of what kind of relationship it wants. And the final point I would make is really to say that the EU doesn't really know what it wants. I mean, I think what we're seeing just now, and I don't want to go into the politics of this particularly, but I think we're seeing a kind of struggle both between the member states as to what the negotiation mandate should be and between the institutions. I mean, Alan Smith's intervention a couple of days ago provoked an extraordinary reaction, which I don't think I've ever witnessed in the European Parliament before. And that raised the question in my mind, is this a Europe of citizens or is it a Europe of member states? And I think at this very moment, we are in the centre of that discussion. It's been one that's been ongoing or implicit since the Greek crisis and all the rest of it. But I think there's a very fundamental question the EU has to ask itself, particularly vis-a-vis Scotland and the rest of the UK, is what kind of union is this that we are negotiating with? So I think there's big questions here, as well as you know, very granular questions, but I think these granular questions will be shaped by the political environment, and these are big questions for the EU as well as for the UK and Scotland.
Thank you very much. That was very interesting. I'll just pass over to Lewis MacDonald.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Can I explore a little bit the very first stage in the process? And we've heard already some evidence from the Cabinet Secretary and also seen some other suggestions in things that people have written, including some of today's witnesses. I mean, I guess there's two things that I'm interested in at the first instance. First of all, it's become clear, and Fiona Hislop, I think, clarified this from a government perspective, that the UK government went into this process without actually having a plan of any kind for what would happen in the event of a vote to leave. That's very serious because it means we're now in a position where so much is at stake and there's very little in place for the UK government, far less anybody else, to judge what to do next. And secondly, there's a question I would like to ask around the triggering of Article 50 and what that requires, because the referendum in law would appear to be simply an advisory process. The decision which would trigger Article 50 is a decision that has to be taken, again, by the UK government. Again, it's not clear whether they have a thought strategically about what that process might be and when they might trigger that. So I'd be interested in your views on all of that, and a specific point in relation to the triggering of Article 50, given that the 1972 European Communities Act makes it a matter of law that we are a member of the European Communities, the European Union as it now is, does that mean that an Act of Parliament is required to be passed at Westminster before Article 50 can be triggered?
Maybe I could start. What Article 50 says in paragraph 1 is that any member state may decide to withdraw from the Union in accordance with its own constitutional requirements. We don't have any. So the question is how is a decision to be taken? And there are three views about that. One is that the decision has been taken by the referendum, although the Referendum Act does not provide that that is to constitute a decision. The second position is that because this is in relation to treaties and international relations, this is a matter for the royal prerogative, which can be exercised without the consent of Parliament. And the third position, and illustrated to some extent by the question, is that precisely because the treaties go into the into personal relationships, personal and commercial relationships, and rights are thereby created and obligations, both for UK nationals and for the nationals of other member states, and that is a matter of statute, that is the will of Parliament, which stands for the time being. It could only be Parliament that authorises the United Kingdom to take the position of commencing a process which is intended to create a situation in which, in accordance with Article 50, the treaties shall cease to apply. So if you ask me which is the more consistent with our constitutional requirements, I would say if parliamentary sovereignty, if we are, continue to believe that we are a parliamentary democracy, then the third course is necessary.
Professor Douglas Scott.
Yes, well, I mean, I agree. Those are the three possible interpretations, and the UK constitution is not very explicit at all on any of these, and it's not helped by the fact that we have no precedents under Article 50, so the EU itself has not been giving out clear messages. Regarding seeing the referendum itself as a possible trigger, the result, I think we're all clear that this referendum is an advisory one, and if Parliament chose not to act on it, it would not have to. So we can distinguish it from other referenda, such as the AV referendum a few years back, which contained provisions as to the follow-up for the vote. But even in that case, if Parliament chose, it could have reversed that by another act of Parliament. But I think what this raises is a conflict between popular sovereignty, as expressed in a referendum, and parliamentary sovereignty, as expressed in what are the rights of our MPs at this stage. I think what is interesting, though, is the conflict between these two second views, which I think is very much playing itself out in London right now, and quite a few prominent constitutional lawyers have been opting for the second of these two views, that a vote in Parliament must be necessary in order to... for the government then to be able to go and trigger Article 50, that it's not sufficient for the prerogative itself just to be exercised. Parliament has to have its say. I suspect this is not going to win the day, though, because when it comes down to it, in the end, the withdrawal from the Union will have to be agreed by Parliament when it repeals the European Communities Act, if that's what it does. So I suspect that there will be enough people who will say, well, Parliament has its say then, because there will be some sort of withdrawal agreement, and Parliament will have to ratify that, adopting a European Communities Withdrawal Act. I mean, the problem I have with the third option, which I think is quite attractive, is that it does constrain the use of the prerogative to go and have any sort of negotiations on the foreign stage. I think that in the case of Britain joining the EEC, as it then was it necessary to have an Act of Parliament before the then Prime Minister could go and negotiate? I don't think so. So I suspect this third option won't win the day, but the Constitution isn't clear. The referendum was fought partly on the basis of taking back control and parliamentary sovereignty. And if there is a strong belief in parliamentary sovereignty, then Parliament should be able to have a say. I think at the very, very least, there will be some sort of resolution or vote in Parliament, even if it's not necessary for there to be legislation authorising the Prime Minister to go and trigger Article 50. But I suspect there will be a majority of people who in the end will hold sway, and that third option will not win the day.
Before other witnesses come in, can I just come back for a couple of questions on that? Because... first of all, my understanding was that the 1972 Act did precede the substantive negotiations before entry. Correct me if I'm wrong on that. But secondly, if you are correct, or if the government chooses to act on the basis that you're right and that it doesn't require Parliament to endorse a decision to withdraw, that presumably will still be open to legal challenge.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Yeah. But I think in the case of the 1972 Act, I mean, I'm talking about actually triggering negotiations, and I think the same argument could be made there. You could say that, well, the Prime Minister of the day, in deciding to negotiate with the EEC over Britain becoming a member, that would have had a material effect on the statutory position in the UK at that time. That would have been an act of the prerogative. Of course, there had to be a European Communities Act adopted to give effect to Britain's membership, but I'm talking about this much earlier stage of, can you just open negotiations? And so I'm slightly troubled about this interpretation that would seem to restrict the ability of the government to negotiate at all in foreign policy matters, wherever there is some sort of conflict between the prerogative to negotiate foreign matters and some sort of act of Parliament. Where are we going to draw the line? We may hamstring the government in that case.
But would that act of Parliament not simply enable the government to go and negotiate?
Well, what we're saying is they can't do it until they get an Act of Parliament. But we don't say that in other matters. We don't say you can't negotiate in other matters without an Act of Parliament.
But with respect, I don't think that's the point, because we're talking about Article 50. Mm. And Article 50 has a procedure which will end in the annulment of an Act of Parliament. Mm. And the question is, do you need Parliament's authority to decide to set that in motion? Now, you can have all the negotiations
that may be possible, although the indications are that the other member states are not in a mood to engage in negotiations without an Article 50 notice. But that's all possible, and of course it was possible before we went in. But at the stage when we had decided to go in, you had to have an Act of Parliament to give effect, prospectively, to the treaties as they would apply on the date of entry. So I think my view is that it's very important to distinguish the right to negotiate and the right to trigger Article 50, which is a totally unprecedented situation.
If you don't mind, can I just go back to something Professor Shona Dulles-Scott said about at the end of this process there being required to be an Act of Parliament to agree whatever had been agreed following the Article 50 negotiations. If at that stage there was came back to Parliament, Parliament didn't agree to that, yet we'd exhausted the 2 years, what would happen?
Well, that's a very interesting question. There would have to be some sort of treaty, some sort of Act of Parliament put into effect, a withdrawal agreement, but there would also have to be a repeal of the European Communities Act. Yeah. And so we're talking about two different things, and Parliament might refuse to do both of them. If it refuses to adopt an Act of Parliament to put a withdrawal treaty agreement into effect, then we don't have that agreement having effect domestically, at the very least. It may be able to take effect internationally, but I doubt it. But in terms of repealing the European Communities Act, if there were no authority for that from Parliament, we would be left in the situation where domestically EU law could still continue to apply in the UK. But it would be a very, very confusing situation because there would be references to the various European institutions which would no longer have sway over the UK anymore. I mean, certain bits of EU law on agriculture or competition might require the European institutions to be involved. And if we had withdrawn, that wouldn't be the case. So the law would be a bit confusing.
So effectively, though, although we might internally in the UK decide that we want to continue with all that process, the European Union would still see us as out at that stage.
Could do. I'd be interested to hear what Sir David would say on that point.
Well, I think it's clear what Article 50, paragraph 3, says: the treaty shall cease to apply to the state in question from the date of entry into force of the withdrawal agreement, or failing that, 2 years after the start. So it would be possible to negotiate the withdrawal agreement, but delay its entry into force, so that it could be the situation could arise where you've negotiated the withdrawal agreement, you go back to Parliament, and Parliament says no, we don't accept that, and therefore it doesn't enter into force. That's one possibility, but you have to remember that I'm not sure that a member state, having gone through this, can unilaterally withdraw at the point when the withdrawal agreement has been concluded, even if it's not entered into force.
Could I just add something on the political side of this? Because you started, Mr. MacDonald, talking about the lack of a contingency plan, which is certainly absolutely extraordinary. In many ways, it was the most extraordinary part of the whole campaign, that the people were voting against something but not for something. And of course, as you know, some people are already talking about should there at some point be a second referendum. And I think it's a very confused discussion so far, and I think it's very confused because people are talking about two different things, but kind of in the same sentence or column or whatever. One is, should you have a political decision, a referendum on whatever this withdrawal agreement is. And other people are saying, or the same people are saying, could we have a second referendum like Denmark and Ireland did, so that although that seems a bit inconceivable politically today, actually we change our minds. Now, it seems to me there are two different things. If you vote on the withdrawal agreement in a new referendum and you don't like it, does that mean the alternative option is, oh, actually, we're staying in after all, we don't even have the February 2016 Cameron deal? I mean, I think that would be utterly, utterly confusing. So I think, you know, I think this discussion about second referenda will continue, but I think we have to be trying to put real clarity into this, that there's two different potential things going on here. And I certainly, at the moment, some people are saying, therefore, that let's not trigger Article 50 either. For a long time or perhaps ever. Politics is changing hour by hour at the moment, but unless we get into such an economic crisis that public opinion suddenly steadily goes 60-40, sorry, this sounds a bit like England copying Scotland, but unless it went in that direction, I at the moment imagine Article 50 will be triggered, that'll be triggered by Christmas, And so that we won't just have a second referendum. And just one other relevant point, if I may, it's quite possible that there will be two sets of negotiations. So one, a very basic withdrawal agreement that can be negotiated within 2 years, so that, as I think you were discussing with the Cabinet Secretary, so that the UK isn't sitting in the Council of Ministers when it said it's going to leave and is therefore a rather unwelcome and potentially obstructive presence, so that the UK leaves within 2 years, and that even if then the trade or association agreement hasn't been agreed, that can carry on over the 5 or 10 years that it might need. But the basic deal about ending budget contributions, MEPs coming to the end of their terms, what you do about European civil servants, has all been agreed. That would certainly open up the question of the transition. If you're out after 2 years but you haven't got a full trading agreement, what do you do? Do you fall back on WTO rules? Do you join the EEA but temporarily? So, you know, there are kind of options within scenarios within options here as well.
I'm going to have to move on to Richard Lockhead, who wants to ask a question.
Thank you. Thank you for giving evidence and your very invaluable contribution so far. It's fascinating. I'm just trying to paint a picture in my head of some of the potential options which you did refer to initially of Scotland being in Europe but the rest of the UK not being in Europe. And self-evidently you can't be a state and a sub-state at the same time, so I'm trying to maybe explore further what that might look like, because I think Dr. Hughes made the point that if you went into the economic area, clearly you'd have to sign up to the four freedoms, and you'd have access to single market, but clearly you wouldn't be representing the EU institutions. Is that correct? And how could that work within the UK practically, in terms of the rest of the UK not having the four freedoms and maybe having a separate agreement over market or whatever? But I'm just trying to paint a picture of what might be possible.
Are you envisaging, what's the constitutional setup in the UK that's under your question?
Well, that's part of the answer. Is that possible?
All right, sorry. I mean, I think that the difficulty of any arrangement that would involve the UK in its present structure, with Scotland having an exceptional position, are, as you say, very difficult to conjure up. Because any one of them not only would have a constitutional dimension, how would Scotland be represented? I mean, I think that the issue about the Greenland option there is probably the one that's somewhere. But the difficulty then, there would have to be some kind of rules of origin agreement between our UK and Scotland, because, of course, Scotland, if it had a more privileged access to EU markets while the rest of the UK didn't, but was still part of the UK, then you would have to set up a whole bunch of arrangements to ensure that English goods, if I can put it geographically in that sense, didn't enter the EU via a free trade corridor that Scotland enjoyed with the EU. So I think you would get into a kind of EFTA type problem where rules of origin would become quite important, and that's just one example of, I think, where it would be quite difficult on a practical level to manage, and it would be more complex than alternative scenarios for an internal UK constitution, if that makes sense to you. You know, why would you do that What's the utility then of the constitutional options you have in front of you? So I think it would be a very complex situation, but I'm not saying it's inconceivable, but I think it's largely difficult to imagine. Could I just make one very brief comment about the plan B that Mr. MacDonald raised? I mean, one of the ironies, and I think one of the things we should be pleased about, is Scotland's actually much, because of our discussion over the independence referendum, I think we're much further down the road in thinking about a lot of these things, because they were on the table when we were discussing that, for good or bad. I mean, it's not a political point, but I think we actually perhaps are further down the road as to what the options are than maybe the UK government is just now, because we have thought long and hard about Scotland's EU future in a different setting.
Briefly, I mean, I agree with what Drew says. I think it would be, how complex it is depends what the rest of the UK is doing. If what we're talking about is a scenario where Scotland stays in the European Economic Association or in the single market with all four freedoms, and Drew's given the rules of origin is a very good example of the technical complexity of it. If you think about free movement, that gives you an example of the political complexity of it, because actually, at one level, it shouldn't be problematic. Why should it be problematic if all the EU 27 have the right to live and work in Scotland, but they don't have the right to live and work in England? I don't envisage, gloomy though things are at the moment, I don't envisage that England or the rest of the UK would say the EU 27 have to have visas and that we have to have visas to go to the rest of Europe. So, you know, Poles and French and Germans would still have the right to travel to England, and they'd have the right to travel in Scotland, but they wouldn't have any legal rights, perhaps, to reside and work. So that's then a very political question for England, is, well, are we fine with the fact that lots of people might still come to Scotland to live and work here, and they can visit us, but do we need to have passport controls on the border to check who's coming in, even though they don't need visas? Or not. Now, with the sort of hypersensitivity and xenophobia around the immigration debate at the moment, they might, but I'm not sure that's not a legal, correct me, but I don't think it's a legal or a technical necessity, but obviously it's a highly sensitive political question. And then if you go to what Professor Douglas Scott was talking about right at the start, is there any possibility of a sub-state sitting in the Council of Ministers? But again, you know, think of another example. What about Russia sanctions? Because if it was possible to sit in the Council of Ministers, then you'd be doing not just the single market, you'd be doing foreign policy. So is Scotland going to take a position on EU sanctions on Russia? Not England and Wales, who are outside, but who still, you know, you're going to have two sovereign states within one. I think all these things are worth exploring, but they'd get very complex quite fast.
Well, on the same point and on the same question, I think it depends on the solutions, the permutations, both within the UK and EU relationships. Taking free movement, for example, if England and Wales were to adopt some sort of Norway plus EEA arrangement, there would be free movement of persons. And if Scotland and the rest of the UK had some other sort of differentiated relationship with the EU, that would be more workable. In terms of constitutionally within the UK, Greenland is a federacy, which means that it has a considerable amount of self-rule, more than Scotland does now, but not a great deal of shared rule. And with arrangements like that, it is more possible, I think, to envisage the sort of future relationship Scotland might have. In terms of having a seat on the Council of Ministers and other institutions, we should remember that there have been parts of the EU in the past that have been members, but not full members to the extent of having been represented at every single institution. That might not be desirable, but all I'm saying at this point is that it wouldn't foreclose any possible agreement. So there are many, many permutations here.
What are the examples of that last point?
West Berlin is an example, for example, not part of West Germany, but very much part of the EEC.
But that was because the provisions of the EEC treaty had a special protocol as to the position of Germany. I personally think that this is starting at the wrong end. It doesn't seem to me possible to envisage a position of Scotland separate, remaining part of the UK, but having a separate relationship in relation to the single market. Customs, all sorts of complications arise. I would recommend to start at the other end. Scotland has certain devolved competences, and one should start looking at what one can do within those competences. For example, the Erasmus programme, which other countries not members of the EU are part of. For example, Horizon 2020. For example, a number of other agreements within the devolved, which are within the devolved competence of the Scottish Parliament and government, which could be negotiated. And I think Horizon 2020 and Erasmus and academic cooperation are of enormous importance to Scotland, given the importance to the Scottish economy, of the universities, and of scientific scientific development. Also, one could envisage Scotland has certain competences in relation to fishing. There are a number of areas, and I would start, it seems to me that one should start building from there rather than starting the other way down and imagining a kind of free-floating Scotland, because I think we cannot ignore geography. It's fine talking about Greenland, but Scotland isn't even remotely Greenland. It's connected by its naval to England. And you have to start from that rather simple fact.
Tavish Scott, did you want to ask?
Thank you. Can I? Yes, I very strongly agree with that last point, and not just the geography of Greenland, but the. But anyway, what I actually wanted to ask the panel was: is your presumption here that the EU member states will all agree the negotiating position? Because it's certainly not mine. For the very reason that Professor Andrew Scott gave at the outset, I don't even know what the EU is anymore, and I think in 2 years' time it'll be even less certain. So what happens if the EU member states can't agree their negotiating position with the UK?
Well, what they have to, strictly speaking, what they have to do under Article 218, there's various steps that have to be taken, and the Council has to give the negotiating mandate so that... there are various stages, and that's why I stress that it's not our option to say how these negotiations are going to take place, and it's precisely for the reason you mentioned that it will be important that all the member states and all the EU institutions are involved.
Mm-hmm. It was just to go back to the point about enlargement treaties, how they are constructed. They are constructed in two parts. One is the political principles are agreed, you know, whatever they may be. So derogations from particular obligations, perhaps free movement of labour, as was the case in the 2004 and 2006. So these political principles are agreed. And then, as Sir David said, the mandate is given to, well, is it the Commission or the Council? This is the struggle we're seeing a little bit of in Brussels just now. And then it's for negotiations to be engaged with the EU and the other party, and the same with international trade negotiations. And then, of course, it goes back to the European Council for consideration, at which point they've got to agree to this, and then the necessary ratifications flow from that. So I think you're right that the EU has not got a negotiating position, but I do think it's right to remind ourselves we're only 5 days into this particular situation. So I would imagine that the EU will not want to enter negotiations in a weak position. I think... quite strenuously, because if we look at the relationships that we have between the EU and its closest neighbours, and particularly Switzerland in the wake of the 2014 referendum in Switzerland that proposed a quantitative limit on inward movement of persons, on immigration, that drew an immediate response from the EU, that triggered a guillotine where six other bilaterals were taken off the table, including Horizon 2020, interestingly. So I do not expect the EU to be confused about its principles. I think they have already stated quite categorically that a special cherry-picking deal is not on offer. I think that's come from the Commission, it's come from the European Council, so I don't expect to be any dubiety about cherry-picking, and I think it would be to send for the EU to send out an extraordinarily strange message, not only to its own members, where we see internal disputes, but also to other partners who have been treated quite differently. Mm. And I think that might trigger a very complex situation for the EU to deal with on its periphery, driven by some kind of special deal with the UK. So I think there's very, very big things at stake for the EU, and that's why I think they will firm up their political principles. But as I say, we're 5 days into something, and we know that we've got serious elections coming in some member states. We've had serious elections which are still not resolved in some member states. So the domestic politics of this is important. But this isn't the domestic politics of the 60s. This isn't General de Gaulle saying no. This is far too complex for that kind of strategy. And that would propel the EU into its own crisis. And heaven alone knows it doesn't need any more political crisis.
Could I just add that Article 50 only requires a majority? It doesn't require unanimity. That is the advantage of Article 50. So if the agreement is not reached under Article 50, you're then thrown back to trying to get everybody in the EU to agree. So I think with the majority in Article 50, we're talking about 20 of the 27 other states.
Yes, but I'm not asking about that at the end. No. I'm asking about the negotiating position the EU takes at the beginning.
Yeah.
And I'm not clear, to go to Professor Scott's point, I'm not clear with French and German elections next year and the row over immigration in Europe, never mind the row in Britain, the row in Europe, and the fact the French finance minister last night in Newsnight absolutely took the opposite line to his president in Brussels earlier in the day. Your idea that all this will get sorted out and they'll be clear about the principles, I think is well, if I may be so bold, is questionable.
Could I just come in there? I actually read the Newsnight French minister last night in the completely opposite way entirely, and I agree with what Drew says. We know that the European Council statement yesterday added in the sentence that said there is no access to the single market without all four freedoms.
But they would all say that just now, wouldn't they?
But they it's political judgment, isn't
exactly.
it? But I.
Yeah.
All that I think the French minister was saying was in very French style, making a threat. He was saying, in a sense, he was talking about the reverse enlargement that Drew is talking about. Everything is on the table. Brackets not said, the status of the City of London and financial services, and if you don't have full services access, which is going to be one of the biggest issues and problems, then there may be some other deal. So I don't think anybody's saying that if it's not a full single market access, free movement would be on the table. Fine, I mean, Canada doesn't have free movement. So yes, it's a very difficult moment. Yes, there are general elections coming up, but frankly, this is a meat and drink of the EU is sorting out these extraordinary difficult positions, and whether that's bringing in, you know, I thought one of the most amazing things the EU did, and wrong actually in my view, you know, it brought in the divided island of Cyprus, you know, rather than using its leverage to ensure that all sorts of amazing things, amazing not necessarily as positive, you know, happen in finally getting there. You're right, it's going to be extremely difficult, possibly quite bloody, but I wouldn't be quite as pessimistic
as you.
Supplementary from Bruce Crawford.
Professor Douglas Scott, you talked about Article 50 in terms of in that main agreement requiring majority agreement. But if within that main agreement under Article 50 at the end of the process, the EEA process is also part of that agreement, does that not also then require every single country to then agree that process? And if that's the case, if we're going to have a Norway, that will require not just the main agreement, but every single country involved in the EU to also sign up to that process.
Well, I think there will be two agreements. There will be the Article 50 withdrawal agreement, settling the end of the UK's membership of the EU. But there will then have to be a separate agreement to fix the future membership, which would require unanimity. So there'll actually have to be two agreements. And I'm really not clear, and I haven't seen anybody who's very clear about exactly what would be the subject matter of Article 50, to what extent it would encompass future trade relations, for example.
I think there's a problem here, because the texts of the Article 50 are not entirely clear, because the agreement is one which would set out the arrangements for withdrawal, taking account of the framework for its future relationship with the Union, taking account of. Some people say, well, that just means it will be taken into account. If you look at the German text, it seems to say that the withdrawal agreement will have taken account of the future relationship. In other words, you have to negotiate the future relationship as well and before withdrawal. Now, there's a problem about Norway, and I said that talk about options is misleading, because the Norway option assumes that you first join EFTA. And in order to join EFTA, you have to have the agreement of the other EFTA states, which are Norway, Iceland, Liechtenstein, and Switzerland. And then you have to have an agreement. You have to, by that means, then you have to agree to join the EEA, which Switzerland, although a member of EFTA, is not a member of. And so you've got permutations not only of 27 other EU member states, but four other EFTA states. I mean, this is like playing chess with 30 other people at the same time. 31 other people at the same time. It's not easy, and the texts go a certain distance. But one shouldn't be glib about the process.
To return to Scotland's position in this complicated process, if we fail to negotiate a position of differentiation for Scotland, and you've all highlighted the difficulties in that position, and the Scottish Government has to go down what it's described as the contingency measure of an independence referendum, what are the implications of the guillotine process, the two-year guillotine process of Article 50 on a decision like that? Dr. Hughes?
Obviously, we know that it might get extended, the Article 50, but that's absolutely not guaranteed. I think the timing is very tricky. There is certainly, as we've seen in this rather short week, a lot of goodwill to Scotland across the EU. And despite the Spanish Prime Minister's comments, I don't think they were surprising in any way. I think the Barroso comments 2 years ago were scaremongering, in the sense that if Scotland had voted for independence, then there is no way it would have gone to the back of the queue and then 8 years to negotiate. I mean, apart from the fact that the EFTAs only took 18 months because they were so close to EU legislation, look at this discussion and all the other discussions about how extremely difficult this is going to be for the UK to withdraw. So why on earth would you go through Scotland withdrawing only to then go through a full accession process to come back in? So I think what would have happened 2 years ago with an independence vote is that there would have had to be negotiations with Scotland over its membership. I don't think it would get most of the UK opt-outs, but probably get the Schengen opt-out. And then ratification of the accession treaty. And so I talked to people in Brussels off the record who were talking about Scotland somehow being in some sort of transitional holding pen. So it wouldn't have a seat again in the Council of Ministers until ratification of the treaties, but it wouldn't have to go through an absurd being out and then in process. And I go through all that for now because I think there is a timing issue here. If you if Scotland waits until near the end of the 2 years to say this isn't okay and now we're having an independence referendum, it may not have had that and it's and had time to have the negotiations with the rest of the UK on dissolving the union before the whole of the UK has left. So it's obviously a very big political question and judgment of whether and when to call such an independence referendum. But if it was only a question of logic, you would call it as soon as possible, in my view. You know, you'd call it anyway, let's say, by next summer, because then you'd actually have had the dissolution talks, with, if it was successful, with the UK before the UK left. And that would make it much easier for the EU to get into some of these transitional holding pen arrangements. Than otherwise, but that's just my.
And does the panel, obviously you're in Europe all the time, does the panel feel that there has, like as you've alluded to, Dr. Hughes, there has been a shift in goodwill towards Scotland from what existed in 2014?
Well, I think the simple point is that 2014 proceeded on the assumption that the United Kingdom, or our UK, would remain. Was and would remain a full member of the EU. And the question was, what happens to Scotland on that assumption? Would the EU be prepared to accept a new member state simply because this was a separating part of an existing member state? That is not the position now. The position now is that our UK is not a member of the Union. And the question is whether and if so, how Scotland can remain a part of the Union as on the assumption of an independence referendum saying yes, that it could remain. And I would also add that I wouldn't wholly discount the attractions of Scotland not seeking to be a member of the EU, but possibly being a member of the of EFTA and the EEA, because that offers certain advantages, full access to the single market, but not all the commitments that would be gone through. And it doesn't seem to me that Scotland makes quite a good fit with Iceland and Norway. So that I think that I. If we're talking about options, that's another option that ought to be explored.
Mr. Scott.
Without seeking to provoke apoplexy with my legal colleagues, why couldn't Scotland be the successor state for the purposes of the European Union? Why not? I mean, that means that the RUK would leave, but Scotland would remain its seat and inherit the successor state status of the UK. That is not, in my view, impossible. If assuming the necessary constitutional agreement had been sought in Scotland and the Scottish people felt independence was its best option, become the successor state.
I would quote what it was said to me by a very senior retired Dutch diplomat when I asked him about the euro crisis. He said, "We will find a way, we always do." And I think that there is not, one should remember that, you know, the lawyers can dance like angels on the point of a pin, but at the end of the day, it's politics that will count. And that's why I started by saying goodwill is absolutely essential.
On that. I mean, I think it's going to be very interesting, this debate that will come about successor state, but I don't think there is a lot of goodwill at the moment. I think Nicola Sturgeon has played it very adeptly. I think the SNP, from people I talked to even last autumn, were contingency planning in a way, even the Leave side, let alone the UK government, were not. But the EU does not want a mini UK back in the EU if the rest of the UK is leaving. In other words, it does not want the awkward squad member at smaller form. So if the idea of a successor state is that you don't want the opt-outs on the euro, the budget rebate, the opt-in deal on justice and home affairs, I don't think that will be forthcoming. And I think at that point people will start saying, yes, the EEA option, Scotland seems to suit you quite well. So I think that's a wider debate that's going to have to come into the Scottish debate at some point.
Professor Tucker Scott, did you want to?
Well, yes, I mean, I agree with what's been said, I think, but I'll just add one point about procedure. If Article 50 is going to be the governing article for this, I come back to the point about majority, that if somehow Scotland, whether as successor state or some other arrangement, can be arranged under the umbrella of Article 50, you're looking for a majority rather than unanimity. Whereas if you are looking to recognition as a new independent state, there may be pressure to go to Article 49, the accession procedure, and unanimity. So I think process is important, although I wouldn't pass judgment on which it would be likely to be.
Okay, thanks. I understand Rachel wanted in.
I think there would be a situation where Scotland would be left out in the cold if negotiations fail in any form between their possible, possibly not negotiating with the rest of the UK, with Europe, and then trying to become part of Europe. Do you think that they would ever be shut out?
In a sense, had that conversation that it's difficult. If the UK was to become a fully federal state, I think the point was made about the Belgian competences are different, and Belgian, some of the external trade competences that the Belgian regions have. So I think if the UK was to totally invent itself as a quite different state, for example, the Canadian provinces have control over immigration and so on, you know, so one could imagine if the British constitution is thrown up into the air, but I'm not sure we're anywhere close to that position. So I think Scotland being frozen out of Europe is not cannot be discounted if Scotland, its position constitutionally is unaltered, or if the UK's position constitutionally remains the same. Mm.
Richard, did you want to come in there?
Just to follow Rachel Hamilton's point, in terms of the big picture, in terms of Europe's future and what Europe's all about, and Dr. Hughes's comments about the awkward squad or looking for opt-outs or whatever, which is obviously for far down the line, but he did raise it. Would it not sound like a really bad message in terms of Europe's future if they were to say no to countries that wanted to join?
I think it would send a really bad message. I wasn't suggesting they would say no, but
you were
saying
they would say no to certain demands.
At some point, and who knows all these options and scenarios, but if at some point Scotland is talking directly to Brussels about being a full member state, and whether that's done with leaving or somehow staying in, there's going to have to be a discussion. I mean, the number of votes are set out by population, and so that's simple. But there will be a discussion, presumably minimally, about Schengen, because obviously Ireland got the Schengen opt-out because of the common travel area with the UK. All I was trying to say about awkward squad is if at that point Scotland wants the budget rebate, the euro opt-out, and the opt-out opt-in of justice and home affairs, it's certainly going to make, it's not going to get that, I don't think, and it's going to make some member states think twice. So I wasn't going as far as saying, and therefore they'd say no. And I mean, one point, just sort of, it's a bit tangential, but I think Spain is obviously going to be very difficult. It's not the only one that may be difficult, but it is going to be difficult. But it's not actually going to be facing, you know, Spain is not about to leave the EU. It's not about to face Catalans demanding either to stay in while it leaves or to look through these options of keeping some devolved, you know. So that doesn't help it that much at home. But I think in the end, as and when and if we get to that stage, it does help it. And also smaller size helps with that. You know, when Turkey was progressing forward in democratic terms 12 years ago, you know, obviously there was still a lot of reluctance despite the agreement to start talks because it was so big. Smaller member states and more developed member states, which Scotland is, all these things play into the politics. And the EU, even in happier times, let alone in these crisis-ridden times, loves to be a pole of attraction. So I think a lot of it plays in Scotland's favour, but there's also hard-nosed politics, whether it's how they're going to negotiate with UK as a whole or how they would eventually negotiate with Scotland.
I'm afraid we're going to have to wind it up there. Thank you very much to all our witnesses. It's been a fascinating discussion, and I imagine we may be seeing you again at some point. Thank you very much. We're going to suspend very briefly and then move into private session.